Hello friends, in fact this essay, the resistance to theory, is a search for a stable cognitive field, whether language is capable enough to provide a stable cognitive field, that is truth. Stable cognitive field simply means simple language, we can say truth. And now this is our fourth lecture, let's see, before explaining these concepts, let's go through the main points. First point is trivium, that is grammar, theoretical difficulties associated with the rhetoric. That's the point. Theoretical difficulties associated with the rhetoric, that is also the resistance, you can say. Now, trivium. Trivium means grammar, rhetoric, and logic. Also, dialectics is the classical model of language. Trivium means three. The three constituents of language, grammar, rhetoric, and also logic or dialectics, you can say. There is a model of language. We have got different model of language now. For example, we have got a literary model of language. We have got a non-literary model of language. Now this is the classical model of language. Within this, means this, within this trivium, language is made unstable by the epistemological thrust of the rhetoric in the semantic function. That means, semantic function means meaning. Then the epistemological thrust means, now, when a stable cognitive field is attempted, what comes in between, or what prevents that is the coming in of rhetoric. That is the meaning. Epistemological thrust of the rhetoric, the semantic function of the language. Means, semantic function means meaning. And in the meaning, for a stable meaning, when the language is attempting a stable meaning, rhetoric comes in and creates problems. Rhetoric is supposed to be considered as an adjunct, or you can say now, ornaments. But certain cases, what happens? The logic and grammar, that will be superseded by rhetoric. In that case, what happens is the meaning becomes unstable. That is what he is trying to tell us is figurative language, figuration in language. Example, we can see that high period, the fall of high period. And the third point is the title of Keats' unfinished epic, The Fall of High Period, is an example. So we are going to see. No grammatical decoding can explain the genitive. Genitive means of, possessive. Possessive case. Explain the genitive in the title because of its figural dimension. Figural dimension is rhetoric. You can see of the fall of and with. Of is the genitive. Genitive case we say always a possessive case. That's all. Now, then he says, the fall of Hyperion, that is the title of his second epic. First epic is Hyperion, that he could not complete. Second epic, the fall of Hyperion, that also he could not complete. Keats could not complete. First one is Hyperion, there can be different interpretations. The first meaning is Hyperion's fall. The fall of Hyperion means Hyperion's fall. The fall of Rome means Rome's fall. Simply. The fall of civilization means civilization's fall. But in that case, there is no problem. In this case, what happens is Hyperion and fall both are figural. That is, figural is part of rhetoric. And then, in the first meaning, if we say the fall of, we are explaining of the possessive. Say the fall of Hyperion, that means first meaning is Hyperion's fall. Like, the fall of Rome, Rome's fall. The fall of civilization, civilization's fall. Like that. Then the fall of Antony, Mark Antony, Mark Antony's fall. Isn't it? Like that. But what is the problem here? Mark Antony is not a figure, means it's not a figure, language is not figuration there, or a trick there, or it is not a prop. Or what we say, it is not a figure speech, you can say. Now in this case it is not like that. Hyperion's fall. the story of the defeat of an older power by a name. That's the meaning. Hyperion's fall here means the story of the defeat of Hyperion's fall by a new power. A new power or an older power by a new. Hyperion is an older power. There is a new power, and that new power has defeated Hyperion, and now the new power has become successful. That's one meaning. Another meaning is Hyperion falling. The fall of Hyperion is Hyperion falling. The fall of Rome is Rome falling. The fall of civilization means the Rome civilization falling. Mark Antony, the fall of Mark Antony means Mark Antony falling. Yeah, then it is a process. Both are correct. The Hyperion falling and actual process of falling. Then we can use actual process of falling. The story is about Apollo, Hyperion's falls and Apollo's success. The story is about Hyperion's fall. Hyperion is maybe some mythical figure. Hyperion's fall and the success of Apollo. Triumph of Apollo. Hyperion falling is an actual process of falling. It is Hyperion can be Apollo, or it can be Hyperion itself, or it can be Keats. Names are interchangeable, not very clear. So it's symbolic, we can say. It's symbolic or figural, we can say. Figural language. Just as we say, there is a Goliath, you call somebody Goliath, then you become such a huge figure, you call Goliath, like that. So here, in the title, Hyperion can be Hyperion, it can be Apollo, it can be Keats himself. Then, Hyperion and fall have a figural dimension. Fall also has a figural dimension. Also could mean the failure of Keats' own first text and success of the second. The first text title is Hyperion. The second is fall of Hyperion. So, first text fails. Then, second text is about the fall of that first text. It can be that. Not there. He wrote two epics. He attempted. First one is Hyperion. That he couldn't complete. Then, second one is the fall of Hyperion. So, it could be the fall of that text. Different meanings. This figuration, it happens like that in language. Also could mean like that, or success. But the second text also fails to conclude. Then the second text also fails to conclude. So all texts are falling. So not only this Hyperion and the fall of Hyperion, but all the texts. You can apply this to all the texts. All the texts are falling. So all texts are falling. The reader and the writer break off. The reader also breaks off and the writer also breaks off. Reader breaks off because unable to come to a final decision. What is the final meaning of Hyperion? The ultimate meaning. Reader fails. Writer fails. Why? Because the writer fails to conclude the second text also. And this is the fearful symmetry. This, the fearful symmetry. You know this, that phrase is from William Blake's Tiger, that poem Tiger. Tiger, tiger, in the forest of tiger, tiger. The fourth line of the first stanza, you will get this. Tiger, tiger, burning bright, yes, in the forest of the night. No, that is, tiger, tiger, burning bright in the forest of the night. Then the fourth line is fearful symmetry. What immortal hand, yes, made this fearful symmetry, something like that. For fearful symmetry, that is taken from that. So here, what is this fearful symmetry? One, reader fails. Similarity, that is the thing. Similarity. So, fearful symmetry is the failure of the reader to come to a conclusive meaning, the failure of the author to conclude the second text. First and second. So, figuration. So, what happens is that you are unable to reach a stable cognitive field. That's the point. That's what he said. Resistance from the constituents of the trivium. Here the trivium, there is a tension within the trivium. The tension is created by rhetoric. And this is the example for that. So, unable to conclude. Oh no, you cannot reach a conclusion. That is a stable cognitive field. You cannot. That's because of rhetoric. So, rhetoric resists theory. Or trivium, one of the constituents of the trivium resists theory. You got that? I simply understand. Then you have got trivium is grammar, theoretical difficulties associated with the rhetoric. So, rhetoric is a constituent of the trivium. Trivium is the class of three. Trivium is three. That's all. Now you have got quadrivium, that means four. So you will see in the next class. Okay. Yes. Now here it is. So the trivium, grammar, rhetoric and logic or dialectics is the classical model of language. Even the classical model of language cannot present a stable cognitive field. That's the point. Even the classical model of language that consists of grammar, rhetoric and logic or dialectics also fails to present or produce a stable cognitive field. Here what happens is, who comes in between, who is obstacle? Obstacle is the second member, second constituent, and that is rhetoric. Example is given here, the fall of Hypea, the title. Finally we have got the fearful symmetry. Then, within this language is made unstable by the epistemological thrust of the rhetoric in the semantic function. So this is an epistemological thrust of the rhetoric in the semantic function. Semantic one, meaning production. In this meaning production, who comes in as an obstacle? Rhetoric. That's it. Then you have got the title is example. No grammatical decoding can explain the genitive in the title because of its figural dimension or rhetoric. So we tried our best. Different meanings, etc. We tried. But then what happens is, we don't reach anywhere. Just as kids did not reach anywhere. Here the first epic attempt was Hypea. Second one, the fall of Hypea. So we tried this. Anyways, but what happens is, the writer and the reader, whatever, they break off. Again, I told you, as I told you in the beginning, this essay is a search for a stable cognitive field. And you can see, he's trying to find out. And you should see this in the background of deconstruction. Language or signifiers don't have a stable meaning. The signifiers, the play of signifiers. That's it. And then you have got, it says, for a stable cognitive field, the rhetorical dimension should be considered as a mere adjunct or a mere ornament. But in the aesthetic response, that is, the present, our traditional literary criticism, the base of traditional criticism is rhetoric. They don't look at the thing. That's what they said. See, you remember, you know, they are interested in what? Tropes, figural dimensions of language. Then they have got form, allusions, then contrasts. Biography, philosophy, ideology, religion are powered by systems like that, not the thing. And they are concerned more about rhetoric and related thing, that is aesthetic response. So the essay directly attacks the existing literary critical theories and proposes a new critical theory which will provide a stable cognitive field. So that's what Demon is attempting, we can say. That's what he is attempting. So he tried, he saw language resists, theory resists, academy resists. Now, the best model of language, that is the classical model, the trivium, there also you find tension, and the rhetoric enters into the semantic function of the language, and what happens is, we can say, therefore, language fails to give or to present or to produce a stable cognitive field. So all those things now being done are not at all stable cognitive field, means truth. They are not truth. That's what he says. Demon says, what is happening around the world in all the universities and academic departments, they are teaching delusion and not truth. They are teaching delusion, not truth. And he says, if you fail to teach literature, it is better to fail rather than teach delusion. Understand? Scholarship. Scholarship is teachable, but you have to teach truth. So whether we can arrive at truth or not. So he is trying to explore the possibility of using language to produce truth or a stable cognitive field. Hope you are following. Bye.